thank you very much for this kind introduction and inviting me here. So, gave a title and a short abstract, which is way beyond what I'm going to actually be able to tell you about. But I just skipped a lot of technicalities. We've been talking about predictions as if it is special for music or anything like this. So I think you all know, I just want to remind you that life could not exist without the ability to make predictions. And in some sense, like the essence of life, and also the essence of intelligence in general, also artificial intelligence, is making good predictions. And essentially, life depends on that. I mean, the line of these two, the line of the deer in this picture, depends on their ability to know what's going to happen, in this case, a few fractions of a second or 2 seconds later. But as you imagine, that's something I've been pursuing for many, many years, even before Jeff Hawking. The notion of valuable traditions or the ability to encapsulate somehow the information in the past, which is relevant for the future, is really a very a key principle in my own work, and I'm just trying to make it much more quantitative. And so music, in a sense, or art in general, is exploiting our natural tendencies to make valuable predictions. And actually, even very, very primitive creatures like amoeba, or certainly a little more complex than that, depend on the ability to make predictions. And actually, this is my very fundamental definition of intelligence. So I'll come back to that. But I promise to talk about what deep learning actually does to our understanding of creativity. So it's not just deep learning. So deep learning is just the last chapter of something which really started a long time ago, and not so long ago. Actually, you can point exactly the time in history where the notion of artificial intelligence was introduced, and it was due to what we now call the information revolution, information and computation revolution, which is due to two people, Alan Turing and Claude Shannon, who somehow together encapsulated this notion of computation on one hand, and information, quantified information, information transfer, and information processing on the other hand. And these two, in some sense, during the Second World War, during the 40s, 30s, and early 50s, of the last century, really brought together what we now consider really the main building blocks of understanding not only our brain, but intelligence in general. I really believe it's all about information processing. And at least I'm taking this very, very seriously. So artificial intelligence was born in the 50s, essentially due to Turing, who suggested that machines can think. And just like ours, another way in a more precise way, actually formulated the notion of computation in a universal sense, which is now the ancestor of our computers, which everybody holds in his hands these days, or in their pockets, and which are much more powerful than Turing could ever imagine. But it's the same concept exactly. I mean, what we now call Turing machine, which is the conceptual, the mathematical conceptualization of what we now call computational, universal computation. I don't have time to get into this. But he already said in the early 50s in his famous work on defining intelligence, what was later known as the imitation game, due to this movie not long ago, is essentially that simulating intelligence, I mean, a simulator of, car or an airplane is not a car or an airplane, or simulating flight, simulating walking is not the actual thing. But simulating intelligence is intelligence. I mean, you can't distinguish it. And so if you actually simulate an intelligent behavior, this is intelligent behavior. It's not simulation, this is it. Now, in some sense, this is the essence of what we now call the Turing test, or the Turing concept of artificial intelligence. And this was took very naively into by many people in the 60s and 70s who actually tried to mimic intelligence by algorithms which are essentially rule-based, they were just spectating. So just like asking alien how do we hear? And then I write a simple program that takes into account his rules, and this would hear for us. Yeah? Or how do we, why do we enjoy music? I ask them, and I'm sure. I ask someone, how do we enjoy music? Then program. And then, of course, it's a very naive, actually, it's a very silly idea, but this was the state of artificial intelligence in the 80s. In the 80s, when I more or less was exposed to this as well, two types of revolutions happened more or less at the same time. The first one is moving from this rule-based system to what we now call machine learning, which essentially, I can't tell you how I hear, or how I see, or how I think, but I can give you a lot of examples. I can show you this is nice, and this is ugly, and this is you, and this is not you, and so on. And from those examples, I can do what we now call statistical learning, or I can essentially generalize from very few or very many examples and extract the rule by induction by the machine itself. So the algorithms went from rule-based to essentially training, learning rules. I mean, those are learning algorithms. They don't explicitly tell you the rule, they tell you how to learn the rule. And then sometime, actually it started in the 80s, and then came back again in the reincarnation of the of layered neural networks into what we now call deep learning. And deep learning, essentially an old idea which was really invented in the 80s, actually invented way before the 80s, in the 50s already, but it came back in this reincarnated many layers of neural networks. And essentially, so if you take the brief history of deep learning, it started already in the 40s with this very simple model of a neuron that we call it inputs. And then it was introduced as a model of cognitive recognition in the 50s and 60s by Frank Rosenblatt and many others in this notion of the perception. Then was put into this few layers, what we now call shallow layers, shallow learning neural networks in the 80s. It was abandoned again due to Babnik and his essentially rigorous theory of machine learning, supporting machine learning. This then came back in the 2000s by the same people who actually worked on it in the 80s. Jeff Hinton, Leon LeCun, and many others, some of them are good friends of mine, but it came back in this very interesting form of many layers, and now we're actually talking about hundreds or even thousands of layers. So this by itself is not very interesting. What is interesting is that essentially those machines can do miracles. Oh, I'm sorry about this Hebrew. Essentially, these machines can solve better than anything we could do before. Things like object recognition and vision, things like speech recognition, text analysis, text recognition, text translation from language to language, analysis of scenes into text and text into scenes and so on. This is quite unbelievable. In some sense, they not only beat all the previous algorithms that we knew in machine learning, but they also beat human performance on many tasks. In some sense, this was the bad news for theoreticians like me. So, just to give you a few examples, I mean, deep learning are now driving cars, they're controlling human-like robots, they do this type of scene understanding. I mean, you show it a picture, and you get this text, for example, this particular image, you show it to a machine, and you get this sentence, two brown birds sitting on top of rocks. Which is quite amazing. I mean, this was a very hard problem just 10 years ago, what we call scene analysis. Essentially, this machine understands the picture and gives a description which is as good as humans could, and so on. Naturally, those machines also start to do art. And this is like the kind of things that we now do with deep learning, actually using them as a generative models, what we call GANs or generative associated models.
This is a real
network. That's right. Anyway, so essentially, they can do things which look like, you know, a little bit obvious. I mean, so I can take a picture of Van Gogh and take an image of some building, and then the network will generate a Van Gogh-like image, a style of this image. So this is not really creativity. Some of them actually becoming more and more interesting. So take something like Picasso and give him a picture of this guy, I don't remember his name, and you get a Picasso-style image from the network, and so on. Or Van Gogh-like. So this is not yet creativity, but it looks more and more, actually those things are evolving extremely quickly. And within a year or two, they already generate movies which are creative, and music which is creative. I just want to show you one One example, which I'm sure many of you know. So this is how a little electric train or something like Bach. And then when we show it to an effort like this, well, so this is a train, taken, of course, from thinking you well know. But let's say an iota. This is what the network generates after 100 iterations of the training. This is after 500 iterations of the training. And this is after 1,000.
The desired label,
as a function of the training. Well, and then Schoenhauer is a movie which I really like, Schoenhauer, and apologies to Eddie who saw it already. But so what you have to see here is what I call the information plan. So on the x-axis is the information that my input has about each of the layers of the network has about input, and on the y-axis is the same information that each of the layers has about the output. And I got, and the circles here are essentially representing layers of networks. So the last one is the orange there, this one, and so on. You should see this, yeah. This is the last one, this is the one before, and so on. So this is the layer closest to the input, and this is the output. And this is the initial condition of the training, just in the beginning of this, when nothing is known. And you see that essentially, because of the random initial conditions, the information goes down very, very quickly. So the last, the first layer remembers everything about both the input and the output, but the last layer is very slow. It's all is down there with very little information about both the input and the output. Now I'm going to train the network in the same way that people train it with stochastic gradient descent, whatever it means. And this is what we're going to see. So essentially, they first climb up very, very quickly, and then they slowly go up and left. Now, I'll show it again. So essentially, there are clearly two phases here. Up to this point, more or less, where you see that they climb up, and then the last layer actually learned a lot about the input, or the maximum input. All the layers seem to know actually this information is decaying because something called the rate of process inequality, which I didn't have time to explain, but essentially it goes down. But then the interesting part of the learning is when they, most of the efforts of the training are spent on, is when they do this slow compression from here all the way slowly and up. And you see that all the layers of this different network trained with different initial conditions and different orders of the examples look essentially the same in this plan and eventually converge up. Up left, which is no information about the input and all the information about the layer. So that's quite remarkable. So this was depicted by Quantum Magazine. So since I can maybe show it to you in a slightly better way, but I just average all those networks. And you see that they first get to this point, which is this interesting point where the layers seem to accumulate information about the input, but it's still not good enough. You see that on the y-axis, on the information about the label, I'm still not very good. But that's how this very slow process, you see the number of echoes there, most of the echoes are actually done in this compression, which I call also forgetting the irrelevant details. So again, as Quantum Magazine depicted, these are by the way two students who work on it, Robin and Moga. And so this is actually the picture. So essentially you have this, let me show it again, I mean, so this is the same image. The fact from A to B to C, you memorize the data in some sense. You remember all the facts in the training data. And then from C to E in this case, you keep on crunching the algorithm. I mean, keep on doing this backpropagation algorithm or whatever error propagation, which is essentially a very stupid thing. Just the error, the training error is essentially zero already at C. It fits the data. But now you keep on training. This was a puzzle for a long time for many people. I mean, why is it that I keep on training the network and I improve the generalization despite the fact that I keep already the training data perfectly? Of course, what happens here is that you actually compress the representation. And this is this slow motion to the left, and eventually you learn much better. So what's actually happening here? So this is the essence of this of our deeper understanding of deep learning. Essentially what happens here can be formalized by this character. Let's say that I want to learn cats, okay? So I'm getting you images of cats like this, many of them. And of course these images have a lot of details, like you know, the fact that the nose is gray and this and the left eye is white, but there's some, you know, all sorts of details in this image which are irrelevant for the fact that this is a cat. So if I show you images like this of many cats, let's say, and some there are a lot of details which are important. But essentially what the model of the network has to learn is this character of a cat, or something much simpler, which ignores all the details. And this forgetting, I mean compressing the representation, such that I actually ignore the irrelevant details is actually the most important part of the learning. And that's one of the lessons that we get from this. So the essence of learning is really about forgetting. How much time do I have? 10 minutes. Okay. So now that once we understand this, we can ask all sorts of questions. For example, okay, so I'm telling you that this plan of information about the input versus information about the output is really the essence of the story. So actually, of course, we have some theorems behind it. In some sense, the trade-off between the accuracy of the model in terms of how well you do output in the training data and the number of examples you actually need to get there is completely determined by these two values, information about input and information about output. So this is something quite incredible. So essentially, this two-dimensional representation of millions of parameters of the model, I mean, this has tons of weights there, is completely captured by these two numbers. Now, so first of all, now you want to ask, okay, so what is the best I can do? What is the optimal model? Is there an optimality bound? Or can I tell you that those machines are actually indeed optimal in some objective sense? Why are they doing better than anything that we know? Maybe there's an alien that's going to come tomorrow and do much better than the same thing. So one of the things that we know we have to do in at least in my business is to prove theorems and eventually prove, okay, there's no alien anywhere that can do better than this particular models on this particular data. Of course, different data can do better things, but on this data it cannot do better. And so essentially what we have is we see that if we have only 5% of the examples, essentially this compression phase, what you see here are those trajectories in colors now. So the purple is small number of echoes and the yellow is large number of echoes, and you see the evolution of the training again. And you see that with small number of examples, this compression phase actually is plunging the information down, so it's not doing very well. It's doing what we sometimes call overfitting. It's not doing overfitting because I'm actually simplifying the model, but it's like overfitting, I call it overcompression. And when you have enough data, actually this compression is improving the transition that you see on the right. So the question is, do we know where these layers are going to lie theoretically? What is really the absolute bound? And to make a long story short, we have a theory for that. And the theory is not new, although in some places it's depicted as new, we call it information bottleneck model. And essentially what this tells us that there is a line in this plan of information about the input and information about the output, this blue line in this case, which is the absolute theoretical bound, nothing can do better than this bound. This is what we call information theoretic bound, in the sense that I don't care about the algorithm, I don't care about the architecture of the network, I don't care how many layers, I don't care how many neurons, this is the best you can do with this data. And what we actually see, those red crosses, that the layers of the network, in this in our experiments, actually converge to this optimal bound. So the question is, but why? What is so clever about this stupid algorithm? I mean, the stochastic gradient descent, which is really not very smart. I mean, just slowly move to some local minima with noise. So what is so clever about it is making those layers optimal. And the answer is, it has to do with the noise in the gradient descent. So essentially what you see here, again, it's a bit technical, I don't have time to explain it, but if you look at the signal-to-noise ratio of the gradients of the error, during the first phase, the first few echoes, you get this very clean, very high signal-to-noise ratio gradient, and then there is this flip, something like a phase transition, to very low signal-to-noise ratio, which means that the network is essentially getting noise more than signal. And during this noise, all this nice compression happens. So essentially, this is really something very Darwinistic. It's noise. It's essentially random fluctuations in the error which are pushing you to be so good. Okay? Now, how is this related to prediction? I have to finish with this. So of course, you all know, this is an old slide. We are, in some sense, of a cycle with the world. Okay, so when I listen to the music generated by the network, this network was actually trained on something which we call trained predictive representation. So we take a neural network, which looks at some window into the past, and is trying to make a prediction about some short window into the future, and otherwise is trying to simplify the model as much as we can, which is precisely what we see that neural networks are doing. So these deep neural networks, using everything that I didn't tell you about stochastic gradient descent and all that, eventually compress the past without losing the ability to predict. But when they do this compression, they actually improve the generalization. And we actually, okay, so this is by the way a slide made by Nori Jacobi, who was also my student. So essentially, this is what happens in art, for example. So this is just an illustration. Why, for example, this famous Van Gogh picture is beautiful? Oh, of course it's beautiful because it's beautiful, because it's Van Gogh and everything. But it's beautiful because it's creating expectations. And in the same plane, information about what it is versus information about what you see at this point is creating some sort of expectations or anticipations. And then when you increase the information about the details of the picture, you get more and more details which are creating new expectations. And in this case, I mean, here you see maybe a very low bitrate, you see some sort of very crude shadow or something, and eventually at the end you see the nice tree and sun and whatever, starry night, whatever you want to call it. And so these are essentially the beauty of the power of the art in this case is the ability to create new expectations which are improved by the prediction, as Danny told us about music, of course, all the way. Okay, so essentially what we say is that we now have the computational mechanism, which is this information bundle thing, which tells us how to calculate the expectations in a signal and how well it is predicted. And of course, when we increase the window, we increase the context. I mean, it's not just the next sound, it's not like the next phrase, it's maybe the next piece or the next chapter or the next composition, who knows what. We are creating expectation from everything we have to whatever the composer is telling us now. And this is done hierarchically by climbing on this scale. And this scale depends only on the statistics of the sound that we have so far. So Ellie and I have been playing with this idea for a long time now in neurophysiology and in other places. And I really believe it, and the fact that it seems to explain deep learning makes it very interesting. I didn't have time to talk about hierarchies. But of course there are hierarchies. And it's not only on one cycle, it's on many cycles, but you know the punchline here is that time itself is shaped by our ability to make predictions. And we have some sort of what I call time fisheye, in the sense that we have higher resolution in short time both in past and future, and these resolutions get closer and closer, and that this fact is generating this hierarchy of perception. So we are very sensitive to the next tone, but then we think about the next phrase, or the next bar, or the next chapter in the piece, and so on and so forth. And this is dictated by the predictability of the environment. And I'll stop here. Thank you.